Clap along if you feel. All right, y'all. Oh, my timer shows me I'm only 3 minutes late. That's good for me. You all know that, so. All right. Our final keynote of the day before it's cocktail hour. And I think the best way to introduce our speaker is to roll a quick video to introduce her. So, yeah, go ahead and roll it,
buddy. Hey, everybody. I wanted to tell you a really cool story about Kim Jones. When I started with Acuity, my first client was Spanx, and Kim Jones was the controller. And loved working with her, learned so much, just not only about accounting and building an entrepreneurial company, but also about just overall kindness and leadership. And she is just all of that and then some. One interesting thing that I learned pretty quickly is that when you work for Spanx, you have to get used to saying and hearing the word bra and panties and all of those things that you don't normally talk about, sorry men, in public. But I want to tell you a one story specific to Kim. About 8 months into my working with her, my neighbor, about three houses down, their house was on fire one night. One of the branches fell onto a power line. The power line sparked, and their house was ablaze. The scene I remember as well is their youngest daughter walked up to the house and saw it burning. And she just, as you can imagine, completely freaked out. And everybody got up out fine, no one was hurt, but the house was a complete tear down between the fire and the water. And the people that lived there was a mother and her two young teenage daughters. And I was telling the story to Kim, and Kim just very empathetically listened. She immediately went to Sarah, and they immediately approved for a supply of bras, underwear, socks, things like that to be given to this family. So I got their sizes, and Kim delivered. And it was just one of the kindest things that I have experienced in my career, frankly. Kim is such a great leader. She's a good person. She's a wonderful mother. And I just thank the world of her. Thanks, Kim, for all that you do.
All right, team, give it up for my good friend, Kim Jones. Come on up, Kim.
O-N-F-I-D-E-N-T, that's me, I'm confident.
Thank you.
Don't want a compliment, use common sense. I'm on my Michelle Obama.
Oh my gosh, y'all. It really is a pleasure getting a chance to introduce Kim. Some of you know Kim, like Sharon and others. She's been a client. She's a multiple-time client.
Yes.
A friend. And almost a family team member. Adam, her husband's here. There he is back there. So has done some work with some of our team and Acuity clients as well, too. But Kim has just been awesome. So thank you for being here.
Thanks for having me, and happy 20th.
Yeah, thank you. Yeah, oh my gosh, it's crazy.
It's hard to believe. I think I was here in year two.
It was right around year two.
One of the biggest, first jobs that you had. And look at us now, 20 years later.
I know.
We still look exactly the same.
Exactly. See why she's a good friend and why we love her to death. Exactly. She knows how to give good compliments. Oh. I do remember that. I mean, we want to get more to Kim's stories, but I will say a story that I do tell about Spanx. And Kim in particular is, it was like year two. It was year two. It was interesting because Kim was just starting working there when we were kind of starting working there too. So we were kind of both joining Spanx at the same time. But it's the only situation ever at Acuity that I can remember, we got hired along with a competitive firm. And so we had to go in as two competitors and work side by side in a competitive situation, which is a really odd, just very odd. And so I remember being so excited when I went home and told my wife, Rochelle, I'm like, hey, we're getting a chance to work with Spanx. The downside is this really big firm called Tatum Partners, who they literally created the CFO space, the fractional CFO space, they also got hired. So I was like, oh no, we're going to get thrown out. There's so much more experience. I remember that after about 30 days, they came and notified us that, hey, Acuity's going to stay and Tatum's going to leave. And I was like, oh my gosh. But I was so afraid to ask why because I didn't want them to reconsider. And so when I finally had enough courage down the road, talked to their team afterwards, like, why do we get to stay? And I remember them saying like, well, you guys at Acuity, you just fit better with us. You fit us, you understood us. And so it was such a shot of confidence. It was so meaningful for us in our journey as Acuity going, oh my gosh, even if we didn't feel we were the most technically competent, you know, we knew we could find like-minded companies.
For sure. I think it's so important in a startup. Like, that chemistry means everything when you have small teams working together. But I also think there's something, like, really unique to Spanx and Sarah's leadership style of believing in people and giving them a chance, even if they haven't already proven themselves. So I think just from, like, from day one of, like, our style of working together, that even though Tatum was the bigger name, there was belief that you could do it.
Yeah. Well, I appreciate that. I think that was fun. It was hugely important to all of us. But so let's go back. Yeah, just to give some context, I think what I love about Kim's journey, and I want to get into that a little bit about her journey, is she's a kindred spirit with all of us in the sense of being an accountant. And that's where you started. Back in the days, like a little Chapel Hill colored, like we
love it.
So these are a big deal to us at Acuity. Every year at AcuityCon, it's a new color and it gets revealed to us today. So it's apropos. Kim was an accounting major at Chapel Hill. Were you kind of a math kid? Like why accounting? Why'd you pick that?
Well, I grew up in a family of engineers. My dad was an engineer. My older brother was an engineer. And so I grew up around people who built things. And I liked the idea of building things too, but I am terrible at like physically building something. That was not a gift given to me. And early on I became interested in business school, and my dad's a really pragmatic guy. And he said, if you're going to go into business, you have to choose a discipline that will help you like get your foot in the door. If you just go into general business, you're too short. You'll never be taken seriously. And I already kind of had an interest in accounting. And so when I started looking at schools, I only looked at schools that had strong business undergrads and a fifth year accounting program so that I could go straight through and get a master's in accounting. And it's so funny, you know, like I graduated from high school in the 90s. And I think like generationally of like who I am, what was happening in the world. There've been a lot of times in my life where I think about my dad saying that, and I interpreted it to mean like, you're a female, you'll never be taken seriously in business. But what he actually said to me was, you're too short, you'll never be taken seriously. And it's funny because 30 years later, I'm actually in the high heel industry. So I'm sure my dad's not with us anymore, but I'm sure he's laughing about that.
And I tried to wear my coolest kicks today that I've got, just I knew Kim would have some, and we're going to talk about these super cool. Okay, look at these. You may get a chance to see them even better. We'll talk about that in a little bit too. So, and so you were at Ernst & Young, right? So what was kind of after Chapel Hill? Like, walk us through like where you've been, where you are now.
Sure. So I've always loved brands. And when we went through like recruiting that you do from your master's in accounting program, Ernst & Young recruited me with this idea that I could join the Coca-Cola audit team, and that sold me from day one. So I joined them. I worked on the Coke audit team. It was a really amazing group of people, an amazing place to get a foundation for my career. And then after a couple of years, I worked for Coca-Cola directly. And while I was at Coca-Cola, I worked in a few different areas. It was almost like I created my own rotational program. But the last role that I had at Coca-Cola, I worked on a joint venture. And it was a joint venture that was bottled water was still new at the time. That tells you something about my age. But it was a three-tier water strategy. It was a joint venture they were doing with Dannon Waters, Dasani, obviously, and Evian. But it was my first experience working with a smaller team and really in startup mode. And I fell in love with it. It was probably my least favorite job in my entire career, but I fell in love with startups. And after that, I went to another startup that was started by the founder of Earthlink. And I worked there for a few years. He moved the headquarters to the West Coast. And I'm from the Southeast. I thought about it for a minute, but wanted to stay in Atlanta. And had accepted a job at Cartoon Network when I got a call from Kenji saying, I really think you should meet this company, Spades. And, you know, I was interested in hearing about it. Before the end of the day, two more people from my network had called me and told me about the same job. And so I listened to the universe, and I ended up going to Spanx instead of Cartoon Network. I joined them as their controller, and I was there for, gosh, probably 8 years. And, like, the high growth, like, time of Spanx. I mean, remember when we were first there, most people had never heard of the brand.
I hadn't heard of it. I hadn't, again, being a guy, but, you know, I had not heard of it. And I went home and told Rochelle, she was like, how have you not heard about this?
My mom thought it was crazy. Spanx, what is that? What do they do? Are you sure you want to be associated with that? At the time, it was still kind of naughty. Now we all know what Spanx are. But after, you know, being there for 8 years, Kenji introduced me to another founder, Freddie Bench at Sweetwater Brewing. And I joined them for a few years. I started as a CFO, left there as a CEO. And then after leaving there, you know, had an opportunity to go back to Spanx, joined Spanx as their CFO, spent, 7 years there, left as the CEO. And now I'm working for the founder of Spanx in her family office.
Fascinating. But I remember those, again, another quick Spanx story I'll mention. For me, when people ask about all the wonderful clients we've, and we have so many wonderful clients we've worked with, one of the things that always comes up is like, okay, what was the, and because we work with so many tech startups, what was the coolest unicorn technology company you ever worked for? What was the most impressive growth thing? And I'm like, Nothing in technology. It was Spanx. And I remember very distinctly being in the office the day, I believe it was Forbes, was shooting Sarah as the cover story as the youngest self-made female billionaire. And I was just like, that was the coolest thing, just that recognition to see what she and the team had done. It was just, it was one for me. I always think professionally, you have those moments of things you get to experience. And sometimes the things that we get to be part of with our clients, right? Of just seeing that and feeling a small part of it was just so exhilarating, exciting to see that. Cause that growth trajectory was not like anything I'd ever seen.
Yeah, it was crazy. I think when you and I were first there, when I joined, I think it was the 14th employee. We still wore pajamas to work. We didn't even have desks or offices. We had folding tables.
It
was fun. People were sitting on the floors and that's what I remember the most, is just how much fun it was. But also similar to what you talked about of just that, you know, and this is how I fell in love with startups, is knowing without a doubt the value and the impact that every single person on the team was driving. Because even, you know, when we were recognized as being that billion-dollar company, the team was still really small. Even at the heyday of Spanx, the team was 225 employees, when I left. So it's, you know, today it's still pretty small, but I think there's that ability, and I know that you see it all the time with some of your clients, I'm sure you all have experienced too, is just to see that magic, and then such a fun ride to be a part of it.
I want to kind of go back and touch on what your dad's story of the being too short piece. And we hadn't talked about this before, but I do remember, I think Sweetwater Brewing is one of my, I've consumed many of their, much of their product over the years. So I'm a big fan. But I remember when Kim mentioned, going to work, and I'd met the founder of Sweetwater Brewing. Was a neighbor of mine who I'd known for years. And so when I mentioned Kim, what he was looking for, I was like, gosh, and we'd been kind of talking, and you were kind of looking for maybe you're such a growth-minded person. You're like, okay, what's something new to start and go? And so I thought, you know, maybe Kim would be interested in this. And so when I kind of talked about you to him, and I was like, well, I think I've got someone who would be great. I'll admit there was a little bit of like some hesitancy of like, well, that's girl pantyhose world. And like, we're men and brewing. And like, it was a little bit of a, like, I don't know. And I think, I can't remember if it was like looking on LinkedIn or somewhere, and the comment may have been like, how old is she? Is she like, you know, Kim's always looked very youthful. And there was a little bit of like, I don't know. I'm not so sure about this. And I was like, you should just meet her. And then very rapidly, like CFO role, next thing you know, your CEO role, like it went quick. They were like, oh my gosh, once Kim was here, they saw it. But is that, I don't know that, I think they were, did you encounter that a lot? I mean, was your dad and that whole like being too short, did he have some sense of like, it is going to be difficult for you if you don't have something, you know, whether it's an accounting discipline or degree or something? I mean, is that stuff you encountered that you, in the way, or not necessarily?
No, I would say I definitely encountered it, but it never held me back. Yeah. But I owe a lot of that to my dad, because my dad knew that things would be difficult, but he was, you know, he was a realist of know who you are, know how to build your own path, have confidence in yourself. You know, one of the greatest gifts my dad gave me, and this may not have even been intentional, but by the time I graduated from high school, I had worked 8 jobs. I knew exactly who I was. I knew what I liked to do. I knew what I was good at. I knew what I was bad at. I knew the types of leaders that I liked working for. And so I think that I've always had this confidence that came from that, of just knowing who I am, that allowed me to maneuver, you know, any situation. A funny story, though, about starting at Sweetwater, you know, so many people were like, what are you doing? You're going from working with all women almost to almost all men. And, you know, beer has a little bit of a reputation. And so I wasn't sure exactly what would happen. And almost like, I would say like 99.9% of the men that I worked with were so respectful. And even when we were out in markets opening new distributors, it was like my reputation came before me of like, oh, she's that girl from Spanx. And what would inevitably happen is the wives would come out because they wanted to meet me and they wanted to know all about Spanx. And so all the men were on their best behavior because the wives were always at every event because they wanted to meet the girl from Spanx.
Oh my gosh.
Yeah.
That's
amazing. So it was like almost like the universe was looking out for me.
Well, and let me talk about, again, I think Sharon pointed it out, and I know you as friends and Adam, but you've got a couple amazing kids. You've got a great family. And so how... You look at this success you've had and all this going on, and you know, this, you know, and Adam probably plays a role in this as well too, but how, you know, he's like, oh great, I didn't know I was going to get called on. But how, we have lots of parents here in the room. A lot of us were attracted to what we're doing here because of, we wanted to keep growing professionally, but there were some things we cared about, whether it was maybe we were our kiddos, or maybe it was aging parents, or good friends, or community, and things like that. How to balance that? So we've always been. I always thought, we were talking about this earlier, that when we built Acuity, I kind of built it kind of for me. I'm like, I just need something that works for me, and I'll figure some things out. And next thing you know, other people started showing up. We were talking about this over lunch. Other people are like, I see. I kind of, that's how I want to work. But it's tough. It's really challenging. Especially when you've got young kids and they're growing up, like how did you and Adam, through all these, y'all have had big time jobs. Has it always been easy? Did you always just have that knack for being able to do it? Was it challenging? Like, talk a little bit about how.
It's definitely challenging. And Adam's sitting here nodding at me as well. You know, I think that I've had so many people say, like, you make it look easy. How do you do it? You know, I want to have it all. And I guess the first thing I would say, and I think everyone in this room realizes this too, it's not easy. It's hard. So I would say for us, it was something that we talked a lot about. We both cared about our careers, but it was also like okay, we're committed. We're going to do this. And we knew that we would be at times making compromises or that we were committing to something that would be tough. I think the biggest thing for me when I think about balance is just, balance is something that's personal. And so what may be my balance might be very different for someone else. And so, you know, for me personally, like my own personal balance, I need time in nature. I grew up in Western North Carolina. I grew up hiking a lot and being outside. And anytime I'm stressed, I can take my dog out for a really short walk and I just immediately can breathe and I feel better. So Adam and I, we don't have weekly date nights. We go on 2 to 3 walks together every week, and that's our time together, but it also allows me to be outside. And then for me, when it comes to work-life balance, like I've always had this mentality of like, I share my family with work and everyone I work with knows all of my crazy family stories. And then at home, like Adam and my kids know all my crazy work stories. And it's just like, I love those blurred lines, and that's like what kept me whole. But I also like, you know, am very respectful that that's what worked for me, and that balance for other people means something very different. You probably remember, like my daughter was 1 when I started at Spanx. I brought her to the company all the time. And so, you know, I intentionally made choices to work at places that embraced what balance looked like for me.
Well, I think that's, I mean, it's hugely important. I think that balance does look different. I mean, are you wired the same way, Adam? Are you the same, you know, do you blur the lines as well too of work and family? Or are you kind of more like, nah, I got to shut it off and. It's good you're similar. It works out well for y'all as a family. Easier to blur the lines where there's beer involved than not as much. You've never worn the men's Spanx before, Adam?
Oh, Adam, yes, you have.
What? Don't worry, Adam, I have too. When I was there working too, if you were a guy there, guess what? They were going to put it in it, so.
You know, there was a period where we made Spanx for men, and the bestseller was a T-shirt. And we learned very, very quickly that men take their T-shirts off very differently than women. So women are used to, you know, you take your T-shirt off from the bottom and you pull it over your head. Men do this number. They grab the back of the neck and just pull it over their head. So the Spanx for Men T-shirt, when you take it out of the package, it's literally, it looks like it's 4 baby dolls. It's about this size. There's a lot of spandex and it holds you in. You look great if you're trying to get in that tuxedo you can't wear anymore. But Adam did do a wear test for me, and when he went to pull it off his head, there was a, you know, it didn't move. It didn't come off. He cut him out of it. There was a brief moment of panic.
Pulling a muscle or something. I get it. Yeah, I remember that. I think that's always interesting, the things happening. We're always happening at Spanx. There were always stories of going back at, and there's a closet back there, and you go and change things out. And I remember being one of the few guys there. There were times we'd be working together, and I'd say, "Hey, Kenji, can you turn your head away for a second? Like we're all talking about the product, and they're showing things, and I'd have to kind of go and sit in the corner like this." But it was always treated very well there. Always the fun group.
But you do get comfortable very fast.
You do.
About bras and panties, and I never realized before working there how many men just can't say the word panty.
Still a little awkward at times.
It was another funny story. Like going to Sweetwater from there, I remember them, you know, like someone apologizing after saying something that really wasn't that inappropriate at all, and I'm like, I used to talk about like camel toes frequently. Seriously. And I immediately earned respect from like all the men. It was like silence. It's like, okay, like this girl.
Yikes, she's gonna bring it. She's gonna bring it. I guess it was at Sweetwater is where you made your first transition, like out of the finance role into, you know, something much broader in leadership, the CEO role. How did that happen? Like, is that, and then obviously it happened again when you went back to Spanx, but talk about that a little bit. How in the world did that occur?
I think just given everyone's background in this room, the first thing I'll say is it started for me with just having a strong background in accounting and finance. My personal experience starting with a CPA firm, I always had a lot of exposure to executive leadership. And so I think very early in my career, like, I got to see how executive leaders interacted with data, how they made decisions, the questions that they asked. And it almost like demystified the role for me a little bit of, and so I was always really kind of comfortable with executive leadership. But then the things that kind of propelled me towards, you know, eventually becoming an executive leader myself, I loved working in startups. So I had the opportunity to wear so many different hats because there were only 14 of us. I did a little bit of everything. And so it gave me an opportunity where I developed not just my core skill, which is finance, which I embrace, but also to embrace my other skill sets, my other strengths of, you know, where I lean into creativity, my passion for consumer behavior. And then when you work with founders, founders are visionaries. I'm a builder, so like just kind of a perfect complement. And that's what happened at Sweetwater. You know, I joined in a CFO role. I think I was their first CFO.
You were, right? Yep.
They had never had a CFO before. And so I think that helped too. The role wasn't predefined for them. And so I came in used to wearing a lot of hats, and I did a little bit of everything. Even in my CFO capacity, everyone on the team reported to me except the head brewer. And that was a smart decision. but I loved it. You know, I was really comfortable because I'd had the experience working at prior startups. I was comfortable leading sales. I was comfortable leading into marketing, because I had always been in situations where I'd been offered that ability to wear many hats and develop other skill sets.
You don't always see that path into executive leadership, dude. Accounting and finance, but do you think that, I assume that helped you, your background in accounting finance and just understanding data? Was that, again, usually don't see that as the path, but in your case,
I think it's a huge competitive advantage, particularly in today's world. You know, first off, like, you'd be shocked how many executive leaders cannot read financial statements. And, you know, I think that ability to just quickly read financial statements to like zero in on the most important data, and have it be almost like just intuitive knowledge that you carry with you is a huge advantage. Almost every executive leadership team I've worked with, like, it's like the first thing we train in executive leaders, because having that foundation, is so important to how you make day-to-day decisions. But then also, like, when you think about today's world, everything's so data-driven. We're inundated by data every day. And being able to cut through the noise and focus on what's the most meaningful data? What are my unit margins? What are my growth marketing metrics? How am I going to use this to make decisions? How am I going to drive growth? I think that having a background in finance just gives you this like almost intuition of, how much risk can I bear? Because when you're working in a growth environment, it's all about taking risk. And then knowing when those risks turn into opportunities, how do I scale it fast? And just knowing the numbers and having them at your fingertips allows you to make decisions a lot faster.
Yeah. Oh, big salute, that big plug for us accountants and all us finance folks. And like we talked about a little bit, we talked about Acuity 3.0. And it's a great point of, we do have so much data coming at us, and us as a company being nimble and adaptable. Now, we're lucky we have innately inside of our organization so many people who are good with data, and we're going to need even more of those abilities because that's how we're going to adapt to the rapidly changing profession right now. So I appreciate you kind of teeing that up. Obviously, you've got the numbers and finance chops. It sounds like you were very observant when you got a chance to see other leaders and executives, and you kind of soaked that up. Did you have any folks like, you know, mentoring? Was there anyone you go to in those situations, or were you just kind of having to kind of play off of observing how other people work? How have you had to, well, I guess maybe you said another way, have you had to go seek other ways to kind of augment that executive leadership ability?
I've worked with coaches, and I've, you know, because I've enjoyed working with founders in my career, I also had an opportunity to work with a lot of people who had complementary skill sets to mine. where, to your point, I absorbed it almost organically by watching others and seeing how they were growing the business, and then and pulling that in and using it to build my own strengths too. You know, I would say like one of the most important things in my own journey too was just, you know, kind of embracing my strengths outside of my core. Like I remember early on in my career when my kids were young, people would say things to me like, oh my God, you're so creative. You put on the best birthday parties or the best gifts for all the kids. And, you know, like I realized I that was a part of me that I loved that I didn't always embrace at work because it wasn't part of my core responsibilities. But, you know, once I got into more of the startup roles where people were just grateful if you leaned in and did something, you know, outside of your core role too, it gave me an opportunity to embrace those areas.
Yeah. Oh, that's very cool.
Yeah. The other thing I would say, though, is just I've loved finding tools like the Berkman, which is one of those personality tests. And that's one that I like in particular. But there's so many out there that I think being also to like, in a way, like almost being able to label, hey, this is who I am. And I have these intrinsic strengths that I'm going to you know, work at and show up with every day is something that like I've encouraged with all my teams that I've worked with too.
When you mentioned working with a lot of different founders, like you having to kind of do that, I mean, I'm not sure. Sarah Blakely is probably just about the epitome of a founder, right? You know, common guest judge on Shark Tank. She's done a million things. Is just always creating. What's it like working with Sarah? Like, how do you two, like, is it just yin and yang and you fit perfectly because of a matched skill set, or is it challenging at times? Like, what's been that like working with,
You know, founders are a unique crew, and I love founders. Every founder that I've worked with, they're a genius in their own way. And so it's been an incredible experience, but I would say most of the time it's very yin and yang, but it's also very much, I mean, Sarah and I worked together for close to 20 years at this point, and we're family. I am not a yes person. I always bring my truth to the table. If we're talking about something that I don't think is the right thing to do, then we'll, you know, we debate it. But we have that trust together to do that. And most people would be surprised to hear this about us, even after working together for 20 years. You know, when I first started with her in this new role, running her family office and ultimately helping her with the startup that I'm sure we'll talk about, we created a chart of authority of like, this is her lane, this is my lane, these are our shared lanes. And, you know, it was something that we both wanted to do together, and we've brought it out once. but I think it's important to just like talk about those things openly. So that we kind of both know what our strengths are and how we're going to bring those to the table to work together. Sarah and every other founder I've ever worked with obsess product. Like absolutely obsessed product to the level of just absolute perfectionism. I mean, she works on some products like for 10 years, hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of prototypes to get it absolutely perfect. Every founder I've worked with has had that. And it's a gift and it's a curse. And I would say like some of our like, you know, probably like biggest arguments have been when we're bringing that level of perfectionism to something that doesn't need the perfectionism. Like, you know, product, like you want that to be perfect as part of the magic sauce, or the special sauce. But it's, you know, if it's a social post that's going to be up for 30 seconds and consumed and then it goes away, it's like, it doesn't have to be perfect.
We got to get back to the shoes, right? Because the shoes, I see a lot of head nodding. The shoes are great. So what's going on? What are these shoes? What's happening here? What's this? Tell us for those who haven't heard, and some may or may not, but like what's the newest startup?
The shoes are Sneaks, S-N-E-E-X. It's a hybrid shoe, a hybrid between a sneaker and a heel. So that's the background behind the name. And then, of course, Sarah Blakely, being the founder of Spanx, loved the X. So, you know, if you all follow Sarah, and if you don't, you should, because she's a lot of fun.
Great follow on social.
A lot of humor to her post. But you know that she's dedicated her career, and her purpose really is about elevating women through product. And creating product that is, you know, embraces fashion, is fun to wear, but also makes you feel good and is comfortable to wear. And for anyone who's ever worn heels, have you ever tried them?
Like, I can't say I have, but
they're horrible. I mean, they're horribly uncomfortable. You put them on and you can't wait to take them off. If you get to the party, you take your shoes off or you carry a second pair of shoes. I think a lot of people are shaking their heads. Like, we've all done this. So it's been Sarah's mission for a long time that she wanted to develop a comfortable high heel. And when I left Spanx and joined her in her family office, she had developed the product, but didn't know what she wanted to do with it.
This is one she's been kind of passionate about and working on for a while.
She's been passionate about it. She's been working on the product for 10 years. And so I joined her in Blakely Ventures, which is her home office. And the way that we're structured is we have her foundation, her family office, and then really a studio startup model where all of her business ideas we can bring to life. And so with this product being developed, it was the first thing that we've brought to life. So what's been so much fun about it is, with as many pinch me moments as I've had in my career, I've personally never had an opportunity until Sneaks to start something from the ground up. So we launched it in August of this year, and it's a D2C brand only, Sneaks.com. Within the first 6 weeks, we had already hit our goals for the full year. In 6 weeks. A lot of white space for a comfortable high heel. And what's been so amazing about this is we did it with the home office team. So we started it as a true kind of studio ventures model of launching this new brand with a group of people who had never launched a company before, but were an amazing team of people, and looked for each of their kind of superpowers of how we could start this together. It's a team of about 8 people. And now that we've proven the business model, we'll be hiring a dedicated team for Sneaks. And then the rest of us will continue to work in Sarah's family office and potentially her next startup.
Huge numbers out of the gates. What's been the, I know fashion world's kind of interesting, people's opinions about things. I mean, has it been all roses, or leading toward like?
It's absolutely not. It's a polarizing shoe. It's not for everyone. It's for people who love fashion, forward style. And I think this is where like founders really bring that magic to what they do. We already have shoes that are developed that are far more mainstream than this one. But it was really important that we launched with something that was disruptive and that would create the dialogue in the press around, why are we wearing heels that are uncomfortable? Why do we do that when there is something that is better? And I've worn this shoe all over college campuses, on campus tours. I've worn it through the airport. And you literally forget that you're in a heel, but you have that extra height that those of us who are 5'4" love to get sometimes. But we knew that we were launching with something that was polarizing, and we knew it would start a dialogue, and that was intentional. And while not all the press around the brand has been favorable, because there are people who say, you know, this is an ugly shoe, like, why would you want to wear it? It started the dialogue that we wanted. And, the fact of the matter is there's a huge demand for height plus comfort. In addition to beating our numbers, what we've already seen is that like close to 15% of the women who have bought the shoe in just 6 weeks came back and bought a second pair. I would say that it's off to a strong start and, you know, could be Sarah's next space.
wouldn't surprise me based on the things that we've been able to see with her and the team being a client, the success before, which would be so fun to watch that happen again. Kim, you've been like such a dear friend to Acuity for close to the full 20 years. We are super, super grateful to have you here with us talking about your journey. I mean, honestly, there's a million stories I think we could ask Kim. However, Kim also, when she got here today, wanted to make sure that we spend a little bit of time around some logistics, letting you all know that Kim's giving away 10 pairs of sneaks across the board to the team. That includes Philippines, St. Lucia, and even some of our tech partners. So we want to leave a little bit of time for some goodies here, right? So we have to figure out how we're going to do all this. Matthew, I gave him a task beforehand of helping figure out how we're going to draw.
He's like,
all right, we're like, this is what founders do, right? Tell us how you want to do this. Okay,
we're going to make it up.
Roll tape, Margaret.
Hold on. Please do this.
USA, Philippines, or St. Lucia?
Go with Philippines.
And again, fellas, you get them. Feel free for you want to try them out. You want to give them to a loved one. I mean, either way, this is going to work out well. So
they're just going to turn this one off too.
Drum roll. First winner.
Maria Elena Molina.
Oh, Maria Elena Molina. Oh, boy. We're heading to the Philippines here in a couple weeks, so it'll be fun to.
Yeah, Maria.
Okay.
You want to stay with Philippines?
Philippines? Which one do you want to go next?
Kim? Philippines. Stay with Philippines.
We're Philippines. Platoon Philippines. A couple in St. Louis. How do you want to do them?
Shara Ramos? Did I pronounce that right?
Shira. Shira Ramos. Woo! Okay.
You're going to be fine. You just gave her some snakes. That's fine.
Okay.
St. Lucia.
How many you want to go here, Bill?
Two.
Two here. Okay, two here. We'll go.
This is so much fun. Anytime.
You will be invited back anytime.
St. Lucia, here you come.
All right.
Kernet.
You are getting some
points. All right. And then one more out of St. Lucia.
Impressive.
Esther.
You are also getting some sneaks.
Sneaks, okay. And then you want to go, Matthew.
Through there. To U.S.
Okay.
We did not plan for this many giveaways. We are winging it, folks.
This is pretty impressive if you did this like all in the last 10
minutes. I know we didn't do that part.
All right. Stephanie Downs.
Awesome.
But we don't have a single man yet. Andrea Brett.
Awesome.
Congratulations.
Good, Matthew.
This is where we're going off the rails.
Okay.
We didn't want to leave out the tech partners.
That's true. Tech partners.
When I couldn't figure out how to get everybody's name in the bucket before this, but I did get everybody's company. So if it's Gusto, you're going to have a four-way fight. If it's somebody that's just here by themselves, you're going to have a one-way fight. If it's Claris, as he gets them, come on.
How many picking out of this one?
We're getting two.
Two out of this one. Okay.
All right.
The two tech partners who are taking home some.
All right. Into it?
Into it.
Oh, into it.
Fight amongst. It's an arm wrestling.
Right? And gusto.
We're gonna do.
And
gusto.
We're gonna. No, the rock and gusto too.
Yeah.
Gusto.
And gusto.
Rock, paper, scissors. In just a second, in the happy hour, we're gonna rock.
Who's
paper,
good? Scissors. Okay.
We have to consult.
Oh, we do. Do we have to kind of whisper over here first? Yeah. You want to pretend like you're
great? We've just made an executive decision.
Yes, for the last two pair.
Okay. We're going to pretend.
We're going to pretend like there's a drawing.
We don't even have to.
And the winner is
Kelly Spangers.
Spangers. Kelly gets a pair. And who could this be?
What's an early wedding present for Mary Margaret Stewart?
For all you guys did to put on Acuity Con.
Thank you for all you do for Acuity. Thank you for being a great
speaker. And thank you, Kim, so much. Kim's going to hang around for cocktails and things, but Kim, thank you so much for everything. So, all right, y'all.
We do have a video to get you ready.
Oh, yeah.
For cocktails. So,
spectacular. Give me 14 of them right now.
Really?
Mm-hmm.
Do you know what's in here?
I don't care. Don't tell me.
I'm very excited to find out the most important question of AcuityCon. What drink is Clay making for us?
All right, let's go find out about those drinks.
Everybody online will be back at 9 o'clock tomorrow morning for the trade show. Everybody else, 5 o'clock across the hall.
Across the hall, where drinks.